Hello, dear friends and colleagues from all over the world. Good evening or good afternoon, based upon which part on earth are you right now. And welcome to the Refractive Surgery Practical Chat webinar, where we will present cases and discuss it with eminent regional and international speakers. I would like to thank all the guest speakers here in this webinar because of their valuable time. They were very much keen to participate in this webinar among their very much busy schedule. Nevertheless, I would like to thank Eva Farm for hosting this webinar. And thank you very much, Eva Farm, for this valuable session. My friend, Anas Ambari, and I will organize, I've already organized this webinar, and I'm happy to moderate this session with him. So now, Dr. Anas will introduce, will start the session, please.
Dr. Ahmed, and I'd like to thank the Eva Farm again. Good evening to you all, and good afternoon, depends. The cases presented in this webinar include teaching points and educational objectives, and we would like to thank our distinguished faculty for adhering to it. We would like to thank them for designating the time to be with us tonight, despite the fact that their clinics already reopened. This is practically an introduction for the educational webinar series directed towards the general and young ophthalmologists, which we are working on at the moment, me and Ahmed. Now, Professor Ambrosio needs no introduction. He is going to talk to us about prevention of ectasia after LASIK surgery. Please.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to participate in this great webinar with friends and overwhelm you with a lot of information about how to prevent ectasia. And it's important to understand that I have financial disclosures, including oculus and brain cornea. And I have to thank my collaborators in Brazil, Portugal, especially the group from Brain, Edilson Leão, Bernardo Lopes, from the great work. When you think about progressive ectasia, there are two possibilities. You can have an impact from surgery in high myopic patients, like in this first report from 1998 from Seiler. And Seiler himself, he published a few months later another case of ectasia in patients with form-free keratoconus. So it's different to understand the pathophysiology, that the cornea resistance and the impact from the environment, including laser vision correcting, and the eye rubbing will be the cause of ectasia because of biomechanical decompensation. A major point is that any cornea may develop ectasia. If you want to avoid ectasia, it starts by telling patients not to rub the eye, not to sleep over the eye. That's a major factor that we talk about in our campaign. And it's important to acknowledge the understanding that aggravation of keratoconus is different than causing ectasia, which are different. The first thing that we learn when we start doing refractive surgery is to carefully screen. That's my first publication in 2001 when I start my fellowship with Steve Wilson. We learned that early keratoconus detection is fundamental. And what is early keratoconus? What is mild keratoconus? We evolve now to susceptibility to ectasia development. And also we should think about the impact from the procedure. And these days we were talking about half of the cornea to be preserved, not only leaving 250 of residual stromal bed. It's important to acknowledge the contribution from Brad Lerneman, in which he looked at a scale score with a weighted stratification factor scale, in which age came as a surrogate of biomechanical properties. Age is a surrogate of biomechanics, but it's not specific, because you can have a 21 years old with a strong cornea and a 35 years old with a relatively weak cornea. A very good, very nice series from 300,000 LASIK procedures from Steve Shelhorn. He saw cases with stable LASIK and no LASIK ectasia in the form-frus category, which is a category of topometric classification, and cases with a normal tomography that developed ectasia, 30% of cases in his series. So it's important to understand that form-frus keratoconus is a complex definition. There is no consensus. We did a global consensus 5 years ago, and there is no consensus what is form-frus keratoconus. Steve Kleiss defined as a fellow eye with very symmetric ectasia with normal topography. This fellow eye would be a form-frus. A mild keratoconus would be a good definition by Jay Krashmer. And if you go back in time, Emsler proposed an incomplete and abortive form of keratoconus that could progress or not. My humble contribution is that form fruit keratoconus is a point with high susceptibility for biomechanical decompensation and ectasia progression. And we came to this definition in this report in 2010. The patient had LASIK in the left eye, no surgery in the right eye. If you look in the right eye, she may qualify for LASIK based on topography and 529 central corneal thickness, but the D in the tomography in the Bellum Ambrosio display and a low hysteresis in this publication from 2010 would indicate susceptibility. Another case that developed ectasia with relatively long topography, despite of residual stromal bed of 304 and PTA lower than 0.4, which is a threshold detected by my colleague Marconi Santiago, this patient developed ectasia. And when we see this type of abnormality, we have to think about the subjective classifications. We sent this case along with 24 other cases to 11 experts. The variability is huge. From 0 to 3, the mode was 0. The same cases were sent to the same colleagues with the different classifications in 8 out of the 11 classifiers. And this different scale with a 0.5 normative scale will have a mode of 0 still, but varying now from 0 to 4. So if you look at this case, that will be a good candidate based on a democratic classification by 11 experts. This patient needs something more. And we understand that tomography is different than topography. Front surface curvature mapping, here you have front and back elevation and curvature and also thickness mapping. We want to make things more simple, not simpler. And that's a very important consideration when we started to work with the Bellum Ambrosio display. And here you can see the threshold for susceptibility that this patient has art max, high D, this would indicate susceptibility. The patient has 20/20 plus or 20/15 distance correct vision with a green topography and should not be considered a keratoconus, but is a susceptible or a Frewes keratoconus. We come back to this case in just a little bit. A very nice report from Elnaggar on a LASIK ectasia, on a smile causing ectasia. He sent me the pre-op tomography data and we could calculate many of these indices. And you can see that despite of the low K, this is something that we call as low K keratoconus. Low K keratoconus is when the K max is lower than 46. And 8 to 10% of clinical keratoconus have a keratometric maximal curvature map in the axial curvature maps lower than 46. And this case has 44.6 and 43.9. So the conundrum of ectasia comes now to over 20 years. We have to understand that this is acknowledged by many of the reports in the 30,000 LASIK procedures by Dr. Bohak. We found 10 cases of ectasia, and these cases were hard to be detected, the risk factors. 3 out of 10 had the residual stromal bed lower than 300, and only 2 out of 10 a PTA higher than 40%. In our series, we had 3,278 normal stable cases of 2 years follow-up plus, and 105 ectasia cases. And you can see here the dot plots of age, PTA, and residual stromal bed. Interestingly, if you go to the IS value, absolute, which means that if you have superior steepening, you would have also a positive value. You see that's very specific, but that's not sensitive. It means that people are obeying the rule of not doing LASIK in patients with asymmetric corneal curvature maps, which is something that is not going to be sensitive because only 22.9% of these cases would have abnormal IS values. The bad D goes to 59%. It can change if you change the cutoff value, but you need something else. And that's part of the great work from Bernardo Lopez in his thesis, in which you can include the disease population, the normal topography eye from patients that had keratoconus in the fellow eye. And this Pentatacam random forest index, which is artificial intelligence based, you increase the sensitivity to 74% and the specificity to 94%. However, you have to include the integrated data with the impact from surgery, and that's the relational tissue altering concept that we presented at the ASCRS. And along with the PRFI and other parameters, including age, you can improve the sensitivity. But you still have cases down here these cases down here lead us to the knowledge of the need for biological properties. And we have one healing from Steve Wilson's lab work and many other contributors, and biomechanical properties. And biomechanical properties were, we started studying it in 2006 with a walker response analyzer. Looking for 41 years old, you see the curvature map from placebo and the shine flu. That's the case published in 2010. Everything will be normal, but you have a little yellow here. When you integrate the data with a tomographic and biomechanical display with the Corvus, in which you have much more data to be analyzed based on the dynamic shine flu response, you have a TBI of 0.78. Very interestingly, the son of this patient with 11 years old, 2020, this is corrected. Relatively normal, innocent topography in the right eye. You have a little bit of inferior stiffening here, though, but here you have a possible. And this is something that we call as very mild or fruscure, comes in both eyes. We see from the first publication, the JRS in 2017, patients that if you optimize the normal topography, patients are going to be detected with a better cutoff value. But this will be an epitome of the ectasia susceptibility. We are aware that cases with lower sensitivity were published in the literature, and it gives us the opportunity to improve, to optimize the artificial intelligence of the TBI, including 25 international centers, one algorithm selected from a large cohort of clinical norms, 1,679 cases, large cohorts of keratoconus cases, and 543 cases with normal topography in which the fellow eye had clinical keratoconus, and these are the unoperated eyes that had exam. So it's interesting to see that the BED-D has a very good sensitivity to detect ectasia in the clinical keratoconus in VAE and the KC, but not the normal topography eyes. So we did artificial intelligence with different methods, different approaches, different algorithms, and the random forest was the best one. And here I present you what we presented at the ASCRS as well. The random forest optimized that you can improve even the clinical keratoconus. You have 99% versus 98.4% here, with the specificity also increasing. But you have cases leaking here with normal topography, normal clinical data that are normal. But here you see the advantage increasing from 75% to 85% on the normal topography eye. It's interesting to see these two situations in those normal topography eyes. This patient has 2015 discrete vision, and the fellow eye would say that she has clinical keratoconus, a mild keratoconus. Considering the TBI, she would be abnormal. So this is a very high susceptibility for ectasia, and this exam confirms form full keratoconus in this VAENP case. However, we have to understand the systematic review from subclinical keratoconus and form full. There is huge variability in the literature, what is form full and what is subclinical. So we have a consensus that true unilateral keratoconus does not exist. And also we have a consensus that secondary ectasia can occur due to a pure mechanical process, and that can be unilateral. So this is the case of unilateral ectasia. This patient comes with a very asymmetric disease. The fellow eye, the left eye, has 20/20 plus uncorrected vision. This patient had a great result with a corneal ring. He moved to London, and then Reinstein did his great examination, his extended examination, including epithelial thickness. He still does the arm scan with the Mianga canal and the Lasik. We got the data to calculate the score, which was normal. And this patient comes back to me a few years later, and he's very stable in the left eye. He's still doing well in the right eye, but I can show you that the TBI 002 looks like confirms the unilateral ectasia that we published a few years ago. It goes to segmental layer, so it's important to understand that we are evolving and going beyond, not over, tomography and biomechanics into the tomography domain for epithelial thickness. This layer, micro-layer tomography, you can see the epithelium, you can see the Bowman's layer, you can see the endothelium for Fuchs dystrophy and rejection, other things. So we are really expanding evolution in the imaging for cornea data. And this is something you can see for understanding. For example, this patient that had the ring, you see the ultrasound and the high frequency ultrasound, the OCT, you can see the hyperplasia, which is a secondary effect from the ring. Because the elevation, the more elevated area. We cannot talk about the epithelial thickness without mentioning the great work from Dan Reinstein with the high frequency ultrasound. But today, because of the great work from David Huan, who invented the OCT, and his collaborator Yan Li, we had epithelial thickness from OCT that has been available for many companies. So screening for ectasia, it goes to artificial intelligence based on multimodal imaging. And artificial intelligence also is important to understand the impact from surgery. It's very important to understand the concept of tissue alter that is relational to the cornea. So in relation to the thinnest point, in relation to the patient's age, we can calculate how the cornea can be impacted. And considering how the cornea is strong or not, in case of susceptibility pre-op, we can improve patient's care. So I'd like to invite you all to the Violet June campaign. 2020 will be a very important year for ophthalmology, and maybe I was having high expectation for the Violet June, the Cure Cones Awareness campaign we started here in Rio. It's not my campaign, it's a campaign from Brazilian ophthalmology, and it's a global campaign, global ophthalmology campaign to bring Cure Cones Awareness. The main message is to tell people not to rub the eye, but it goes much beyond that, explaining patients about Cure Cones, which is truly a new subspecialty. However, violet is a very important color because it means healing, rejuvenation, and that's all we want to have in this difficult time. And June is the month we are coming back to normal. Actually, the new normal is coming. So I invite all of you to consider posting on Violet June in the next weeks. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. That was a great talk, and we very much appreciate that you took the time out of your clinic to be with us. I think Dr. Ahmed has the questions of the audience.
I have a question for Renato, because thank you very much for a very valuable presentation, very informative one. And you summarized everything regards the detection of susceptible eyes. I like this term, susceptible eyes, for keratoconus or ectasia. And you concluded that we are going now for the era of artificial intelligence, with which I totally agree with you that we are going now for this era. But do you think that we have some time, some sort of application or some sort of instrumentation based on artificial intelligence, and we will abandon the subjective or the clinical sense of the clinician for the detecting of ectasia, just the input some data for the whatever the gadget or the machine, and this will tell this eye is susceptible for ectasia and this one is not, and we'll abandon the clinical history for the patients and the clinical examination?
Dr. Assaf, that's a great question. Thank you for that. The main point is that we have to go beyond but not over. And we have to go beyond but not over topography, beyond but not over detecting keratoconus. We want tomography, multimodal data, and we want to understand susceptibility for ectasia development. In this sense, I go beyond but not over our clinical judgment, which is limited by our minds. However, the computer is not going to teach us how to do it. Maybe science fiction is coming with some of these concepts, but I do believe that the computers are here to help us, not to replace us. And if you're clever, we will be even more important with the computers than before, because we still have the judgment. We still have to take care of these patients. Just received, this is a printout from the, just received now, the next patient that's coming into the door. So I cannot give a robot to tell the patient what is going on. It's probably very anxious, and we have to tell the patients. That's why we still have to make our decisions, and we still have to do our jobs as clinicians before anything else. But we have the data to take it in consideration to make better decisions for the patient. So I believe that the machines are going to help and help more and more, but not replace. I know that some people are feared about that and they want to deny it, but this denial is getting even going to eventually bring the problem even worse, that is never going to come.
Okay, thank you very much. We appreciate your presence here. I know that we are in the middle of your clinic and still a bunch of patients now are waiting outside. So, Anas, do you have any questions for Renato before leaving?
No, we highly appreciate it. And thank you very much for the time you designated for us today.
Thank you. I'll be around here. I'll try to log in back to see more discussions and learn from all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Safe.
So let's move on without any further ado. It gives me a great pleasure and honor to introduce to you Dr. Rashid Alsaidi. Can I ask you, Dr. Rashid, to share a screen, please? He's a fellow of the European Board of Ophthalmology, head of Ophthalmology Center, Muscat, Oman, chief editor of the Oman Ophthalmic Society Journal, and the president of the Oman Ophthalmic Society. Dr. Rashid, please.
First, I would like to thank Dr. Anas for inviting me, and I thank the panels. And my case, just I want to move the screen a little bit. Make it small, okay. Topic today, one size does not fit all, customized KXL protocols. Okay. I have no conflict of interest here in this. First, I'll give a small short information about Oman. Those they don't know about Oman, Oman located in the Middle East and South African half. The keratoconus, the commonest, common than many other countries. We did this a study in Oman about the keratoconus prevalence, and we found almost 7%. And Oman country, very old country also, where we can, the population living together since long time, some tribes staying and families living in some cities and small villages together since maybe thousands of years. And that's why when we did this study, we found some families, they have up to more than 20% prevalence of keratoconus on those families. And this is the reason, maybe you can see this some inheritance in these families where the main, those susceptible to develop keratoconus or ectasia of the cornea. And it's published on Oman Journal of Ophthalmology. Our ophthalmology center serves almost more than 1/4 of the Omani patient with keratoconus. We have experienced more than 10 years now in the field of treating keratoconus. Actually, our clinic started almost one of the first clinic in Oman started KXL treatment in Oman. And we have pediatric also KXL clinics, and we have a dedicated keratoconus clinic and contact lens clinics where we are seeing, we are doing every year around an average of 150 cross-linkings in our center by itself for local patients. We cross also pediatric, but pediatric clinic, we cross them all from the beginning without even waiting. But for others than pediatrics, usually till last year, we cross links only those cornea above 400 microns as peer protocols. And most of the time we see them two visit at least or one visit at least before we start cross linking to evaluate the patients. Keratoconus of thin corneas was not there in Oman. We used to follow all the normal protocol, which only above 400. And those patients, they are more than 400, less than 400 microns, we wait. Of course, they get contact lens or glasses. We wait, they get advice. But many of those patients, they progress to high drops or scars. And those patients, they need some type of keratoplasty. That's why we were, and the second problem in Oman, we have many patients, young patients, they present to us late. They don't come except when they have already their vision very, very, very much affected. I don't know why, but most people, they wait. That's the problem, the challenge what we are facing. That's why we are always looking for some customized way to treat those patients. Especially most of those young patients, they come with clear cornea. No high drops, no scars, no opacities. So we think that we can help them not only to wait till they develop, they get advanced, and they need more invasive treatment like keratoplasty. We know from the different protocols, there's a stromal demarcation differ from type of treatment to others, EB on or EB off, and type of Dresden or other types developed. There's so many developed protocols. And from this, we can conclude that from this, like this graph, we can conclude that different protocols has got different parameters. So different depth on the stroma, demarcation depth. So all, most of them develop that, so that safe to the endothelium. From here, we took the idea of we may develop something parallel customized treatment for some of those young patients. We can save them, those they have corneal thickness around nearby 400, like 20 micron less or so, without any official or other labeled protocols. We can see from this photo also here, EB-on always gives a higher demarcation in the stroma. Sorry, this one here. And if we go to the accelerated one, also deep, but if we look at the Dresden KXL, still the best actually. Dresden KXL still the best from the demarcation line, but because of the time takes long time, difficult for the patient and for the patients, most of the people they try to avoid and they're going to accelerate some type of accelerated type of treatment. Here from this graph, we can see from this graph that showing comparing riboflavin soaking time. Power and time and energy dose, we can predict the how deep the demarcation going to be in the cornea. So from this we predict that, and we can see how deep, and we can modify and customize those parameters so that will safe for the cornea to do cross-linking even for those patients sub 400 micron. Here, and we know all that Professor Cosimo Mazzotto has published M nomogram recently, end of 2019, it was published in the journals. And his idea same, that to customize the parameters only, not to use another machine, same parameter, but different numbers, so that this be safe for the cornea, not to affect the deeper layers and endothel of the cornea. And actually, we were looking for this. Actually, myself, I met the in our center, we see so many patients late comers. When they come to us, they are already below 400, but they have clean cornea and they are young, still around 16 years old. So we feel very bad to wait only for them till they develop more advanced findings. So we were looking for some type of treatment. From here, the Professor Mazzot has published in his bathymetry-based accelerated cross-linking the M nomogram for standardized treatment of all thickness produced ectasia cornea. I was very happy to read this one and to see this, the safe type. Also, he published pulse versus continuous light accelerated corneal collagen cross-linking in vivo qualitative investigation by confocal microscope and corneal OCT. Pulsing the light during KXL treatment induce a higher penetration of photooxidative effect, at least 40 microns over the continuous UV light exposure, as demonstrated by confocal and OCT. That means continuous illumination can be an option for treating thin cornea because we'll give like 40 microns safety margin. Here, what we use till for the last 10 years, we use the standard accelerated KXL. We treated more than 1,000 patients in Oman, maybe much more. But we use the standard way, which is accelerated KXL. And we use here, you can see here, 30 milliwatts UV powers, 7.2 joules fluence, and pulse illumination 1:1 total 8 minutes. And 10 minutes soaking with isotonic riboflavin 0.1%, one drop every 2 minutes. No riboflavin during UV light. So far, we have achieved good result. Our failure rate is around 5 to 7%, despite having many advanced cases. When we say 5 to 7%, we do more than 150 patients a year, and most of the many patients, not maybe one third of the patients, advanced cases. Here we see this late present, unfortunately, common in Oman. This is the case which I'm going to present. Very interesting case. It's 16-year-old school girls. Can see here. First visit at the Ophthalmology Center in September 2019. The chief complaint deteriorating vision in both eyes, not using glasses, not known to have previous ophthalmic or medical problem, found to have both eyes keratoconus. Both eyes keratoconus stage 3, fogged steroid blast, Fleischer ring blast, otherwise clear cornea in both eyes, no apical scarring. We can see here from this here, you can see Kmax for the right eye, 67.6, and Kmax for left eye, 57.6. Thinnest Bakke 368 right eye and left eye 389. As we can see, both eyes below 400, but left eye better. We can see here from a pentagram topography. We can see the Kmax here, 67 for the right eye and left eye 57. And both eyes in KC3, right? And we can see the parameters on the cornea. What treatment? What high risk patient we have here in front of us? Very high risk patient, age wise, KC stake, and pachymetry wise. Risk of KXL complication due to thin cornea versus conservative management. We discussed this between ourselves and with the patient. We did counseling for the parents regarding all what could happen to those patients. Parents agree when we told them about the risk and what we are doing to customize to get better for the patient, and especially the patient 16 years old. So what we use for this patient, actually this was without protocol, still normogram still not known that time. That time in September was not published still, we didn't know about it, but we try ourselves to make our own little bit amendment for the protocols. So here we see we use EP off accelerated treatment for left eye, the better eye. Abnormal gown was not available at that time. Decided to go for continuous illumination instead of pulse to use less fluence. Stromal depth will be less, hence more protection of endothelium. A treatment setting for left eye, I said, the better eye. Epithelium, as we do always, 8 milligram epithelium off, 8 millimeter, sorry. Fluence 5.7 joules and continuous illumination for 3 minutes. 10 minutes soaking with isotonic riboflavin 0.1, one drop every 2 minutes. Pachymetry reading, pre-op usually we do, done 395. After removal of epithelium, you can see here the pachymetry was 366. And after soaking with riboflavin, pre-UVA 390. So date of surgery was in September, same month, after 1 week of presentation. Follow up so far, day one, usually we do day one, day seven, 1 month, 1, 3, 6, 8. No complication, as you can see here. No cornea edema, epithelium was healed by day seven, endothelial cell count 2,586 on day seven. We can see here Kmax pre-op 57.6 and all over and was stable to 57.1 after 8 months of presentation. That's mean last 2 weeks ago, we saw the patient again. And we can see thinnest, the pachymetry of course valuable, but because of epithelium not maybe changed, still lower a little bit. Vision improved very much, and also this one factors. We can see that from the OCT, you can see that the demarcation where still there's plenty of safety margin between the demarcation line and endothelium. So this was successful, you can see here. And from topography, you can see Kmax pre-op 57.6 and post-op 57.1. You can see here the improvement, very clear improvement in all points. And also KC stake from KC3, the patient after 8 months going to KC2. That's meaning there's improvement. You can see here the topography also. Compare, for example, pre-op, the progression very clear, improvement there after the treatment. Every month there's improvement, and after 8 months, the improvement very clear from the parameters here. Now the right eye, the difficult eye. The right eye we were scared to do in the beginning, and then when we knew about the abnormogram, we discussed with Professor Mazota, and we got his advice as we are new in the field of the, such cornea. And he advised us to go to, for bathymetry between 350 to 400 protocols. And we did that. What we did for this patient, epithelium of same, 8 millimeter, 15 milliwatts power, 5.7 joule fluence, and pulse elimination 1-to-1, total of 12 minutes, 10 minutes soaking with isotonic riboflavin 0.1%, one drop every minute. Riboflavin, one drop every 3 minutes during UVA. Also here, what we added during ultraviolet application of UV light, also every 3 minutes we use to apply drops. So that from the beginning, the calculated demarcation line was 280 micro microns, and stromal depth in Africa was between 250 to 310 for this patient. We can see here, pre-op bathymetry was 365 for the same patient, and after removal of epithelium 348, and after soaking with riboflavin pre-UVA 366. What the post-op, you can see here. Date of surgery done February 2020, and three months ago from today, no complaint. The patient came last visit recently. Epithelium was healed by day 7, endothelial cell count 2,558, and mild central haze, they were grade 2 noted in the last visit, which usually from our experience with treatment will go. The demarcation line we can see here, deep, but there's large safety margin for this patient. If you compare the Kmax during from first visit September 19 to February 20, the patient has progressed more than one number. And after 3 months, regressed and or stabilized the patient. And the thinness bathymetry, you can see it here, is progressing already, but here after that gets stable after 1 month, and here get low because could be because of the epithelium also. Vision, of course, did not improve because maybe of the central corneal haze, which we think this with time will improve. Here we can see, you can clear in the pre-op, the Kmax for at least 68.8 here. And that's mean better improved after 3 months. And we can see almost the parameters have been changed to better Kmax. You can see here between first visit and second visit pre-treatment, the progression was very clear in all points, Kmax. If you can see here, all 48, which is 46. This here still, this first visit, second visit, pre-op. Here, C, number C, the post-op, and this one, 3 month post-op. We can see the difference, this improvement very clear. In conclusion, KXL protocol can be customized to suit the bathymetry reading by adjusting riboflavin soaking time, UVA power, and exposure time. Demarcation line can be used as an indicator for assessment of treatment efficacy. Abnormogram is a useful tool to pre-calculate the demarcation line and adjust treatment setting accordingly. Thin cornea below 400 micron is no more contraindication for KXL. There's new hope for patients with progressive KC thin cornea. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for sharing your customized protocol. And for this very interesting talk, I think for the interest of time, we're going to postpone the questions for later on, if that's right. We'd like to exit the share screen, please. We move to our next esteemed guest speaker. It gives me a great pleasure and honor to introduce to you Dr. Tarek Elnaggar, Fellow of the Royal College of Surgeons, Assistant Professor at the Research Institute of Ophthalmology, Cornea and Refractive Surgery Consultant at the International Eye Hospital in Egypt. Dr. Tarek will talk to us about pseudo-keratectasia, please.
Thank you, Dr. Hannush, for this introduction, and thank you for the invitation. Thank you, Ahmed Assaf, of course, my friend and my colleague, for the invitation, and Eva Pharma for organizing such an elegant meeting. And thanks for the guest speakers from all over the world. First, I would like to start my presentation. can you see my slide here now?
Yes, yes, we can see it, yeah.
Okay, I'll try to be very quick and try to share with you some practical cases. Those cases actually refer to me. Since I became Ectasia magnet, I think I received so many cases with Ectasia from my colleagues for second opinion, for treatment even. Let's start with the first case, and let us think, this is the keratoconus or not. Actually, this is a very steep cornea referred to me to treat as it was diagnosed as keratoconus. You can see that the K-max is 50 diopters, and it is not that thin, but if you look at the tomography here, you can see that regularly arranged and thinning to the center of the cornea. Okay. Can you hear me well?
Yes, thank you.
Some sort of unstable connection or something? Okay, great.
Okay.
Analysis here. Yeah. Okay. You can have a look on the holiday analysis, and you can see here the anterior elevation and posterior elevation blotted again is the best fit ellipsoid, which is automated in this report. And you can see there is no ectatic area in the central area, which makes you feel like it's a ectatic condition. And you can have a look on the tobometric staging system here. Also, some abnormal indices. And here is a bad display. I know Renato would like to have a look on this, but it's above normal limits. And there is, of course, difference between diagnosing keratoconus and diagnosing surgery for a case or not. But what I mean here is this is not a keratoconus case. And here is the other eye showing the same thing with elevated and symmetrical astigmatic area, abnormal elevation, and normal topographic indices. Let us have a look on another case. This case was referred to me as keratoconus with for treatment. And you can have a look on this area, the steep area, inferiorly located in the most suspicious area in the cornea, with 49 diopters K readings, with even with artificial intelligence here telling you that this is a keratoconus type 2. And this may answer the Ahmed Assaf question to Renato, that if we have a look on this and just be blind and not look at the history or the clinical data, and you think this is a keratoconus even stage 2, and go ahead and treat it with cross-linking or even implanting intracorneal rings for this case. But let us have a look on the tomographic map, and you can see that the elevations and depressions are not related to the ectatic area on the or the elevated area in the axial map. And you can see that even with the ectatic area, 49 diopters, there is no associated thing. There is no associated anterior or posterior elevation. And here is the clinical data, and here is the holiday report. And of course, it is suspicious. You can do LASIK for such a case. But let us have a look on the Shine loop images. You can see this bright area. This is simply a superficial scar in the cornea. And this superficial scar, we know it leads to some sort of depression. And this depression is superiorly. But because of the cornea is just continuous tissue, there is associated compensatory elevation, which can lead to misdiagnosed as keratoconus. Actually, you don't have to think such a scar. The scar is already cross-linked naturally. You don't have to cross-link such a case. You just follow it up, you do PTK, you can do whatever, contact lens. This is not a keratoconus. The machine failed to diagnose it as a pseudo-keratoconus. What about this case? This case is Ectasia or not. This is a post-refractive surgery treatment. I used to present this case for a long K read, very high. The steep K is 53, actually. and there is an area of elevation on the curvature map, and even reaches 54, for example. But this case is post-hyperobic Lasik treatment. Of course, you shouldn't reach this limit if you are going to treat hyperobia, but the surgeon did a hyperobic treatment for this patient and leads to a pseudo-keratectasia like you have seen in this one. Let's have a look on an interesting case I presented last week. If this is ectasia or not, this is what we will decide here. A patient referred to me is a male patient, 38 years old, with blurred vision, post-Lasik, done 3.5 years ago. His vision is 20/40, corrected with -1.5 to 20/25 in the right eye. In left eye, he doesn't have astigmatism, just -1.25, correcting to 20/25. Let's have a look in his maps. There is an area elevated, inferior. Of course, you should be suspicious. This could be an ectasia. The surgeon who performed this case diagnosed it as post-Lasik ectasia and referred it to me. And here is the left eye showing a similar image with 47.7 Kmax. And of course, the machine will be misled by the tomographic data here, the topographic data, sorry, and give you the impression that this is a keratoconus 1 or 2 staging, and the left eye showing also abnormalities. But let us have a look on the tomographic data. Again, the tomographic data showing there is no associated thinning in the elevated area. There is no associated elevations posteriorly in the elevated area in the axial map. If we have a look on the holiday reports, and the of course it is fitted again, perfectly here. The anterior and posterior elevation doesn't show any abnormalities. And here is the left eye showing the same, and you can see the holiday report. The problem is sometimes you can't get the preoperative or the operative data. Sometimes it's hidden, sometimes you can't find it, sometimes it's hidden because of the medical-legal aspect, but I dig deep and I was lucky to find it. Here is the preoperative data and operative data of this patient. The patient was suffering from myopia and astigmatism, as you can see here in the right and left eye, and it's corrected to 0.8. This is the best corrected distance visual acuity. And you can see that the attempted refraction used by the surgeon is a little bit under correction. And he chose to use a narrow optical zone of 5.75 millimeters. Here is the pentacam preoperative. The cornea is originally T cornea with regular astigmatism and no abnormalities in anterior and posterior curvature maps, but relatively thin cornea for such refraction, especially when you are correcting a high astigmatism. And here is the topometric indices. And here is the holiday formula showing, holiday reports showing no abnormalities in the anterior and posterior surface. And the Abelian Ambrosio display can show some sort of higher D than normal. The normal D value is 1.6, and you can see it's a little bit high, but this is because of the initially steep cornea. And here is the left eye showing the same thing. So the cornea is originally steep. And another factor here, if you can have the printout of the machine after the treatment, you can see that there is some sort of superior decentration in the left eye, in the right eye, and abnormal ablation in the right, in the left eye. And this leads to decentration of the ablation done. One of the underutilized map in the pentacam is the comparison map, and I like to use comparative maps pre and post operative. And you can see here, if you compare the pre-operative to the post-operative, you can see that the area that shows some elevations, it is related to the flap edge. Flap edge healing can give you some sort of elevation, like you can see here in the comparative map between the pre and post-operative. And also it can give you a clue that there is some sort of decentration. The decentration, and here is the comparison between the posterior elevation pre and post-operative. There is no posterior elevation occurred because of the operation. And here is a pachymetric comparison map between the two cases. And you can see the ablation is a little bit decentered superiorly in the right eye. And here is the left eye showing the same findings with a little bit of decentration also in the pachymetric comparison. Pseudo-keratectasia is not a new term. Actually, Jean et al. Reported this in the Journal of Cataract and Refractive Surgery 2005, reporting pseudo-keratectasia after hyperopic LASIK, which was reported as a keratoconus-like topographic pattern in otherwise normal eye. In this case, I believe that the preoperative steep cornea and the decentered ablation plus the small optical zone and the flab edge effect gives you this false impression that it could be a take-home message. Tomography is more important than just looking at the topography. Tomography gives you the full picture, and preoperative data and different MAB are valuable to take your decision. And please, finally, don't be judgmental when you look at the tomography. You should look at everything possible in your hand and give your conclusion. Thank you for your kind attention.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Tarek, for sharing this very interesting case. I'm sure there are many questions, but in the interest of time, we're going to move on, please, if that's all right. I think Dr. Sadeer Hannush should be ready. All right, perfect. So it gives me a great pleasure and honor to present to you Dr. Sadeer Hannush. He's an attending surgeon on the cornea service at Wills Eye Hospital in Philadelphia, professor of ophthalmology at Thomas Jefferson University. He received the Academy Life Achievement Award last year. He conducted several major clinical trials, had more than 100 peer-reviewed articles and more than 20 book chapters, and he has more than 30 visiting professorships. Thank you very much for taking the time. I know you interrupted your surgical schedule to be with us. We highly appreciate it, and we're waiting. Thank you. Can you hear me, Dr. Hannush?
Hello? How about now? Are we on?
Yeah. Yes.
All right. All right, super. Thank you, Dr. Anbari, for that kind introduction, and to Professor Assaf for hosting this wonderful meeting. It's an honor to be with you today. I thought what I would do this afternoon is to share with you an interesting case of an unhappy toric IOL patient. The only financial interest I have to disclose is we are about to start a double-blind study doing decemy stripping only with and without ripostil that COA is sponsoring. I also will give you one other disclaimer. My case is not one of keratoconus, so you don't have to worry about a keratasia. So, very simply, patient referred to us with a history of uneventful cataract extraction with toric intraocular lens implantation. He received a T6 lens, and the patient is very unhappy. The referring surgeon wasn't sure of the reason, so referred him to our cornea service for further evaluation. This is an important slide, and I'll come back to it. It's a very simple slide. His unaided vision is 20/40. His best corrected vision is 20/40, but he pinholes to 20/20. Again, he doesn't correct better than 20/40, but he pinholes to 20/20. Hint, hint. All right, so this is the patient. He received a toric implant. You can see the hash marks. This is a right eye, and the hash mark, I'd say, is at about 140, 150 degrees. I repeated the biometry, got about two diopters of cylinder at 175 degrees. And I looked at it and I said, okay, you're not too far from the intended axis, but still he was not refractable. I could not improve him with refraction. To make it very simple, the macula was pristine, the capsule was clear. And many people, when they see this case, they say, oh, we know what's wrong. This lens has to be rotated. another 35 degrees or so using one of the multiple formulas that are available to all of you online. When you do placebo topography, and there was no need for tomography here, you can see the surface is quite irregular. So yes, the simulated keratometry measurement is 2 diopters against the rule, but the surface is irregular. And the reason the surface is irregular, he has frank basement membrane disease, frank basement membrane abnormalities, whether you like to call it a dystrophy or degeneration, that's a topic of a different conversation. But the surface was irregular. That's why he pinholed to 20/20, but was not refractable to 20/20. So after evaluating him and discussing his options, I decided to remove the epithelium in the basement membrane. And this is done in the slit lamp at the office. Simply remove the epithelium. It is critical to remove the basement membrane. You can't just remove the epithelium because, as you know, the irregularity is in the basement membrane. 2 weeks later, he returns. Slide left is the topography of the irregular surface. Slide right, what you see here, is a smooth surface. The simulated keratometry is of 0.5 diopter of astigmatism. And what's interesting now is that the patient, and the wavefront aberrometry also shows you a simulated refraction of +3/4 diopter and -2.75 diopter at 140 degrees, okay? When I repeated the biometry, he doesn't pick up much cylinder at all. So that's the story. So now the surface is smooth and the patient is still very unhappy. Reason being that his refraction is +1, -2.75 at 140 for 20/20 with a spherical equivalent of 0.375 diopter of myopia. So what is happening here, as you all know, is that the toric implant, which he did not need in the first place, is inducing the 2.75 diopters of cylinder. The power was the correct power, as you can see from the spherical equivalent, but the toricity is one that he did not need. So once we smoothed the surface and got rid of the, to use Dr. Elnaggar's term, he used the term pseudo-keratasia. This is pseudo-toricity, because it was basically irregular astigmatism. The implant itself induced 2.75 diopters of astigmatism. So the question is, what do you do now? What are our options to fix his problem? You know he corrects to 20/20, but with a high degree of cylinder. All right? So what I'm gonna do now is give you the management options that I thought of. And then since we have 180 or so people on this call, we're gonna do a poll and have them vote. Option one, spectacle or contact lens correction. Option two, IOL exchange. Option three, some type of cornea-based laser vision correction, PRK or LASIK or SMILE. Option four, a piggyback toric IOL. And option five, another procedure. So I'm gonna ask Mr. Mohammed Hassan to put the poll up. Mohammed, can you put the poll up for the audience to vote? Thank you, sir. You all have 10 seconds to vote. Good. All right. I like what I see. Good participation. We need more of you to vote. Okay, Mohammed, give it another 10 seconds, please, so we get more people voting. Don't cut them off yet. All right, I need more of you to vote. There's only
panelists cannot vote.
No, the panelists cannot vote. That's right, Professor. Panelists cannot vote. But the audience should vote. All right, so I think we'll end the poll here. We have a good representation of the people online. And basically, roughly half of you are divided between IOL exchange or a cornea-based laser vision correction procedure, with a few choosing the conservative option of a contact lens and a couple of piggyback toric IOL. Mind you, this patient is unhappy, he's already asking the surgeon to give him his money back. You've all been there, right? So, okay, you can take the poll off. Mohammed, you can take the poll off and we'll finish, we'll show the audience what we did. Okay, let's see here. You want to take this off? I don't need to see it anymore. Everybody's seen the results. All right, I'm gonna move forward, but I need this to come. There we go, I'm gonna put it in the corner. You can cancel it anytime. Let's move forward and finish up here. Basically, what we decided to do is to remove this toric IOL. The capsule was intact, so this was a very straightforward procedure. We delivered the lens out of the bag into the anterior chamber, bisected the lens, took it out of the eye, and all of you use different techniques to do this. There are many ways to do this, but the principle is we took a toric IOL that the patient does not need, reinflated the bag, and put a non-toric spherical lens bag and back into the capsular bag. So 2 weeks later, unaided vision 2015, patient very happy, referring doctor very happy. I'm happy, although we did not resolve the issue of the fact that he paid for a toric implant and he had to resolve it with the referring ophthalmologist. Thank you very much for your attention. In conclusion, a toric IOL at the time of cataract surgery is a great method to improve unaided visual acuity in the setting of corneal astigmatism. Incorrect toric IOL choice and off-steep axis placement are not the only causes of reduced unaided visual acuity postoperatively. Careful evaluation of the corneal surface is mandatory to rule out other causes of irregularity that may give the false appearance of corneal astigmatism and preclude patient satisfaction after implantation of a toric lens. I'll take a question or two, but then we're gonna have to go back and finish our surgical day.
Thank you very much, Sadeer, for this wonderful case presentation. I truly appreciate the importance of corneal topography before deciding the toric implant for the patient. Let me ask you a question. Did you have your money back, the difference between the toric and non-toric lens for the patient or not?
Well, I did not do the original surgery. So in the United States, a standard implant is covered by all insurances. So there's an out-of-pocket expense for a toric lens, and the patient was going to address that with the referring ophthalmologist who did the surgery. And I'm almost certain he was refunded his out-of-pocket expense.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so what kind of basement membrane dystrophy, this method of peeling of the basement membrane, what is it applicable to any kind of anterior corneal dystrophy?
No, it's not applicable to any anterior corneal dystrophy. This is just for dystrophies anterior to Bowman's layer, of course. So we're talking about basement membrane dystrophy. And basement membrane dystrophy, since the IC3D in 2015, most of us feel it's not a dystrophy. It's more common in women than men, true, but usually associated with chronic blepharitis. So most of us think it's a degeneration right now. It causes two well-known symptoms. Obviously, one is the recurrent erosion syndrome that everybody knows, whose management I did not discuss today. But many times, even in the absence of recurrent erosion, it manifests as a visual disturbance, meaning blurred vision because of a surface irregularity. And the only way to solve that after you've tried your artificial tears and hypertonic saline or whatever is to remove the epithelium and peel off the basement membrane. It heals very quickly, and these patients do very well. Many of them will ask you, what is the possibility of recurrence? And I tell them it will recur, but may take many, many years to recur. In a 32-year practice, I can't remember coming back to do a keratectomy for the same indication in less than 10 years.
Okay, a couple of questions, very short questions. What about the surface area? How large do you are going to peel the epithelium and the basement membrane from the central area of the cornea? And how long are you going to wait until doing corneal topography again to test the corneal surface after healing the epithelium?
So in answer to your first question, Dr. Assaf, I usually try to remove the central 6 millimeters, which is usually the visually significant area of the cornea, similar to the area of, let's say, ablation with laser. So I remove the 6 millimeters, but if I see significant abnormality around it, I would go to 7 or 8 millimeters, obviously staying away from the limbus. The rule, how long to wait before we make a final decision, is, as you know, you want refractive and topographic stability, usually a few weeks apart. This guy, he healed very quickly. He had a smooth topography. There was no reason to wait when I was able to refract him to 20/20.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much. We won't interrupt your surgeries much more. And we appreciate your presence with us here among this very busy schedule of yours. Thank you very much, Sadeer.
It's an honor to be with you. You all have good rest of a conference. Bye for now. Be careful, safe, stay away from COVID.
Yeah, thank you very much. Can you stop sharing with the screen, please?
Will do.
Okay. Now I'm switching now to my dearest friend, Dr. Arthur Cumming from Ireland. He is the director and CEO of Willington Eye Clinic in Dublin. And of course, he needs no introduction. As you know, that Arthur has many publications and researches among the refractive surgery, and he has many presentations and webinars. I think Arthur is doing 2 or 3 webinars each day now, since the COVID lockdown. I see you everywhere. And of course, every time I listen to Arthur, I learn something from him. So he is really very good teacher. He's very good scientist. Dear Arthur, now it's all yours right now.
Thank you, Ahmed. That's a very, very nice introduction. It's very nice. It's my pleasure to be here. And I want to share 2 cases with you. These are cases that I thought would be very good for young residents thinking about getting into the space. And I thought monovision is a very good topic to talk about. And then I started thinking, you know something, this is probably the perfect time not to speak about monovision, but rather to speak about blended vision. Okay? So words matter. Words are very important, especially at this time when people are so nervous. And monovision, I have it, but it has a negative connotation in the mind of a patient. It sounds like one eye is doing one thing and one eye is doing another thing. And it often makes people think they only need to have the one eye treated. So a much better term is blended vision. It's a lot more positive. It sounds like things are working together, which they are. And then also there's no suggestion of only one eye being necessary. Obviously, often you're going to only have to do one eye, but that's a nice surprise for the patient. When you speak about monovision, people are sometimes surprised they need the second eye done. So I think words matter and blended vision is a better term. So there are quite a few things to consider. One is, which is the right eye for the right task? So most people speak about motor dominance. I've been doing monovision for the last 22 years routinely. So I've done something like 8 or 9,000 monovision cases or blended vision cases. And I find people do a lot better with sensory dominance and putting distance vision on their sensory eye. Something that can help you an awful lot too is a ferropter or a loose lens test, and a contact lens trial is also very valuable. Now in the COVID era, we're not doing many contact lens trials at all. So then really the ferropter test is very valuable. You simply show the patient right eye dominant, right eye for distance, left eye for near, swap that around and see which one they prefer. So another question that gets asked is how much should the reading eye be undercorrected? So what we typically do there, I'm going to give you on the next slide, I'm going to invite you to photograph the screen. There's a YouTube link and you can have a look at this on, I've got a 10-minute video on YouTube that shows you exactly how to do this. So the first thing you do is you correct the patient both eyes fully. They look at the sun and chart and you ask them to rate it when you show them Monovision. And anytime they rate it more than 80, you know there's a really good chance it's going to work. If they rate it under 80, then maybe blended vision is not the way to go. But 85% of people rate it above 80. And then you show them a stereo target, and you defocus the reading eye until they lose stereo, and then you come back again. So I never do blended vision if it's going to take away the person's distance stereo. They're not going to appreciate that. And then also it's important, obviously, to figure out what your patient's work requirements are. So I'll just leave this here for a second. You can just photograph that if you're interested. And it's a video that shows you how in your rooms, using the phoropter, to do a test that shows you exactly which eye to choose and how to decide how far you can undercorrect the reading eye. This is just another example of a patient who's due for surgery. So this was a patient who we were planning treatment. Cornea looks fine. It's a little bit on the thin side. So we sort of have this unspoken rule that if you are under 500, we tend to go surface ablation. In this case, the BAD was fine, suggesting you could probably do LASIK, but we decided to do surface. And this is the topography, again, showing that things look pretty okay. What I want to share with you is the BAD. So in the previous slide, you saw the BAD was 0.83. Now, a BAD of 0.83 is 0.83 if the patient is 30 years old. But for every year under 30, you can add 0.05. So if this patient was 28, instead of being 0.83, the BAD is actually 0.93. So you'll see as you go younger, the BAD is becoming higher, making you think more about LASIK, or rather thinking more about PRK than LASIK. And then the same thing for every year over 30, you can subtract 0.05. So if this patient was 6 years older, was 36, their BAD is actually 0.53. And this is from Michael Beelan. Michael Beelan told me this personally. That's how he uses the BAD. And then I went ahead, did a PRK. Of course, we use a nomogram. You need to follow your results yourself so that you know what nomogram to use, and also that you know with your technique and your climate and with your laser, does mitomycin impact your nomogram? And we normally use 0.02 mitomycin for 20 to 30 seconds, irrespective of the amount of treatment we did. And then this patient got a very nice outcome, but I got a very interesting surprise. And this patient presented with shingles about 10 days later. And this was one of those times, we're normally very good about this, but this was one of those times we didn't specifically ask about a history of herpes simplex and zoster, and we should have picked it up with this patient. So if we do have patients who are having surface treatments especially, and they have a history, we would normally put them on icyclovir 200 milligrams 4 times a day for a prophylactic dose, all the way through the healing period while they're on the steroids. So thank you. I'm going to share another case with you if that's okay.
Yes, please.
All right, so this second case is a patient with high hyperopia and also some amblyopia. How do we address this? So one of the questions people often ask is, how high can I go? So the first thing about that is you need to know your laser. And every laser has its own idiosyncratic behavior depending on how high you're going. We've heard Dan Reinstein's name earlier this evening with epithelium, and Dan routinely goes to +7, +8. I don't go that high. The highest I ever go is sort of +6, and most times not really much more than +4, but it's a very personal thing. So if you're going to start with hyperopia, start lower and slowly but surely go higher and higher and see at a point where you think you're not happy anymore. This is a very important sentence. Look at the final projected Ks and make sure that they are below 50, and even better, try and keep them below 48. How does that work? If you've got a +3, and your cornea is 43, the +3 is going to induce 3.6 diopters of steepening. So now your 43 cornea is going to go to 46.6. That's below 48. That's fine. And then epithelial mapping is very useful to inform you whether you can do a further enhancement if required. So here's a patient who's got a K of 44, the mean K, and here's a patient with a mean K of 41.2. So those two patients will have a different amount of hyperopia you can treat so that you don't go too steep. So always start with what is your starting K and what's your projected final K. And for hyperopia, you multiply by 1.2. For myopia, you multiply by 0.8. So it's less flattening that you get with myopia, much more steepening than the dioptric value. And this is a very, very useful map. If you have epithelial mapping, and this patient has already had a hyperopic LASIK, irrespective of the case, these cases could be 43. And you're thinking, I need to do some more. If you look at your epithelial mapping and you see that the epithelium is already significantly thinner over the apex of the treatment, then it suggests you shouldn't be thinking too much about doing too much more, because you're going to get to a point where the central epithelium is simply too thin and you get a chronic breakdown. So in the old days, it used to be just about how steep you go, but today epithelial mapping helps you a lot to decide how steep you can go. Then obviously for hyperopia, it's mandatory to do cytoplegic refraction. You need to assess the effect on alignment if there's a big difference. With latent hyperopia, we would normally do 30 to 50% of the difference. So a plus three manifest, plus five cyclo, we'd normally do a plus four, maybe slightly less. And if you have a very big delta, a big latent hyperopia, then contact lens trials can be very, very useful. You need to explain latent hyperopia to your patient. They need to understand it. It takes a lot of time, but it saves you so much trouble down the line. What's very interesting is especially with latent hyperopia, even if you're under-correcting the cycloplegic, you're going to, on the short term, you're going to get an overcorrection, and it's very important to explain this to patients. And here's a very nice trick that not everyone is aware of, but it really works well. If you've been hyperopic all your life, anytime you want to see well, you sort of squint and you stimulate accommodation. You're trying to get to see as well as you can. And that's the way you've been trained for 30 years, 40 years. And now suddenly you have a treatment done, and now for a while you're recovering it and the epithelial is remodeling, you're slightly myopic. And what do you do when you can't see? You induce accommodation, increasing the myopia, making it even worse. So what we tell patients in this recovery phase is you've got to stop doing that. What you've got to do when you're not seeing well, when the TV is a blur, close your eyes, just relax, let your vision relax, and then slowly open up and see. And often that helps them get through this initial phase where they're over-focusing. We'll also ask patients if they're happy with their current corrected vision, because the moment you do a high hyperope, you're going to get minification. Like with myopia, we get a lot of increase in best corrected acuity because of the magnification. You get the opposite with hyperope. So more important to think about that. You're more inclined to have amblyopia. Does the patient who has amblyopia in one eye, do they wear both contact lenses? And if they do, what are they wearing the second lens for? Is it mostly for balance, for increasing the visual field? It's important to manage expectations. So sometimes the opportunity for with amblyopia one really ends up, you can also do the pharoptical, the loose lens test. And then there's a very nice sentence that really makes them understand this. And you can tell them, you know, your whole life long, the one eye's been lazy. Now we're going to assign that eye for reading. So your good eyes getting worse and worse for reading. Relatively speaking, the amblyopic eye now is starting to enjoy more of an advantage, and you can find it improves. And we'd normally so often over the years. And that I'm very comfortable telling patients that. But for someone who's very pedantic or very demanding, I'll just say, look, it's work is when you're in the supermarket, you forgot to bring your glasses, and you're going to have to then close your dominant distance eye and read your. Vision that's called the blended vision that's tricky, and they're trying to get the lazy eye working better. It's to help you with that. So thank you very much for your attention. Thank you so much, Anas and Ahmed, for such a nice conference and for inviting me to participate. I've really enjoyed it and learned a lot so far. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Arthur. As usual, I learned a lot from your presentation, and I like the term blended vision more than the monovision, because definitely it's scary for the patient that they will turn to one eye patient. I would like to ask you about the blended vision. Let's say is it applicable for myopic patients? Do you do such blended vision for myopic patients, or do you have something to do with the Q value in these patients or not?
So those would be what we used to call advanced monovision, when you start playing with Q. You can do that, and we have some nice technology that can help you with that. But mostly what I do, more often than not, is either with an IOL, if I'm doing blended vision rather than a multifocal, or with LASIK, is just this thing where you do the test, you give the person a stereo target, and then you see how far you can defocus them. And in the 8,000 or 9,000 cases we've done, I would reverse a blended vision or a monovision maybe once a year. So it's all about those patient expectations. And I think, you know, the conversations we have today with patients about multifocal and trifocal IOLs, we've become quite good at explaining to patients we're going to improve their functionality. We're not promising them total freedom from glasses. And if you have that approach and you're simply telling someone you're going to make them more functional, you're almost always going to be super surprised on the positive side. I was a -3 in both eyes, and 10 years ago, I had this eye to 0, this eye to -150, and I've never looked back. So it works very well for myopes as well.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. One more question. Blended vision works with the, is anything to do with the right-handed steering wheel cars or the left-handed steering cars?
That's such a good question. It works very, very well. And so it's a question we have. The only time that comes up, though, is if a patient says, I can't tell the difference. So we do the testing for them and they're saying, I do it this way or that way. Then we'll ask them where they drive, because we have a lot of patients, even though they're Irish, they're living in Spain or whatever, and where they spend most of their time driving. And we drive on the left-hand side of the road, so we would then tend to the right eye for distance, or vice versa. So when my wife had this done, she's also right-hand dominant, and she obviously drives on the left-hand side of the road. But with her test, she much preferred her distance vision in her right eye from a sensory point of view, and she had it done that way around, and she has no problems driving at all. So be very flexible, but if you have the choice, better to have your distance eye closer to the white line.
Okay, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
I have a question for Arthur, please, if you have time.
Yeah, sure.
I have a question regarding correction of hyperopia. Do you experience some sort of improvement in near vision after correcting hyperopia? Sometimes the hyperprolate cornea after correction of hyperopia gives you some negative spherical aberrations that mimics the breast biopic treatment profile, and some patients are happy with near vision, although we don't promise them to correct the near vision, but we correct just the hyperopia for far. But some of them are reading fine after doing just hyperopic correction for far vision. Do you have the same experience, Arthur?
Yeah, absolutely. You're 100% right. And you write about how it works as well. You've induced negative spherical aberration. What's interesting with doing it with IOLs, if I have a patient who's decided not to go for a multifocal, but they rather want some kind of blended vision, they're a higher hyperope. We always do the distance eye first. And every now and then, I'm guaranteeing you, all of you have seen this, is you do a high, maybe a +8 or so, you put in an emmetropic eye, or emmetropia, you happen to get emmetropia, you see the patient in the waiting room reading, and you're thinking, oh my goodness, I've got too much myopia here. And you find afterwards they can read and they can see far. And then you know when you treat the second eye for reading, you don't have to target -150, you can target something much less. And I think hyperopes are very interesting, is they tend to get with laser or with IOLs, they tend to get more reading than you bargain for. But again, we don't tell them up front. You always want to surprise them. You want to surprise them positively. Other than you. Great questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think in the interest of time, we should move on. Are you ready, Ahmed?
Yes.
Perfect. Thank you. So, it gives me great pleasure and honor to introduce to you my dear friend and colleague, Ahmed Assaf. He's a fellow of the Royal College of Surgeons, professor at Faculty of Medicine at Shams University, consultant at National Eye Hospital, Cairo, Egypt. Dr. Assaf will talk to us today about LASIK retreatment and beyond. Please.
Thank you, my dear friend Anas. I would like to share with you my this is a case of retreatment, Lasik retreatment. This is a female lady, 43 years old, coming from Canada for diminution of vision for distance as well as for near. And she reported that the diminution of vision is more at the night time. She had the previous laser refractive surgery 12 years ago. Oh. She's not sure about the procedure, whether it was LASIK or surface ablation. She has no previous refractive surgery record, and examination showed the cornea is clear. There is no haze. No abnormality could be detected in the anterior and posterior segment. The corrected distant visual acuity in both eyes is 1, and she can reach 1 with addition of 3/4 of a diopter. You can see the refraction here in the right side of the screen. She has almost 1 diopter of astigmatism in both eyes. Most probably, this is the reason of her dissatisfaction after the LASIK, 12 years after the LASIK. And she asked for solution for this case. You can see this is the corneal topography or tomography, let's say, and you can see there is no abnormalities regarding the anterior or posterior elevation maps on the right as well as on the left side, like the mentioned Dr. Tarek Nagar. So we can exclude now the ectasia as a reason for diminution of vision in this case. And you can see that here in central flattening, the anterior surface of the right eye as well as on the left side here, you can see that the astigmatism is almost topographic astigmatism because the axis here of the refract astigmatism matches the axis with the topographic of the astigmatism on the right side as well as on the left side. You can see this is the astigmatism on the left side and this is the topographic astigmatism on the left side. So most probably this patient suffers from low order aberrations due to some sort of regression after 12 years after the her previous surgery, whatever it was, LASIK or it was surface ablation. We did OCT on the anterior surface to confirm if this is some sort of corneal cut has been done or not, and we didn't found any LASIK flap here. So we concluded that this is case of surface ablation had been done 12 years ago. So my decision in this case is to do another cut with the femto LASIK. So I did femto LASIK both eyes with blended vision. It's not mono vision or micro mono vision I've just mentioned, and her left eye was the dominant eye. The left eye we target the 0, and the right eye we target minus 0.75, just some sort of micro mono vision, and we assigned the topography guided LASIK ablation to correct the low order ablation as well as trying to smoothen somehow the surface of the cornea to improve the visual quality. And you can see here, this is, was my plan. At the time of the surgery, this is the left eye, this is the dominant eye, we target here 0, and this is the right eye, I'm targeting here 0.75 of myopia. And this is the LASIK flap, everything was fine for the right and then for the left side. And this is the topography guided ablation profile for the right side. You can see this is the topography guided ablation profile. And to correct some sort of, let's say, coma on the eye, this is the left eye and this is the right side here. You can see some sort of coma. We can correct this coma with a topography guided ablation. And this is something already I have learned from Arthur and how to target myopia and how to target emmetropia in these cases. For this, the left side, we did just couldn't get clear TCAT maps. So we just went for the custom Q ablation profile, not about the topography guided, because we didn't get a quick good quality TCAT photos. So we just straight ahead went for the custom Q ablation to correct the astigmatism of this patient. And after 2 weeks, the patient was unhappy. She is not satisfied with her distant vision. She reported improvement in her near vision because of the myopia induced in the right side. But surprisingly, the left side now shooted to hypropia. And I was waiting for regression at that time. So she would come back after 2 months and still there is hypropia in the left side and the myopia in the right side. She is still pleased at that time with the reading ability on the right side, but she is completely dissatisfied with the distant vision in general, obviously because of the dominant eye, which is the left side in her case, is suffering of a significant amount of hypropia. So what to do in this case? I ordered again for topography, and you can see here there is nothing wrong. We could increase the ablation profile here. The ablation zone now is much larger than before. So we covered all the pupillary area on the right side as well as on the left side. There is nothing wrong. And we asked for epithelial mapping to see if there is some sort of epithelial hyperplasia, maybe responsible for this regression. But as you can see, this is the epithelium of the right side and this is the epithelium of the left side. They are typically normal and typically equal on each side. So there is nothing wrong with the epithelium in this case in particular. So most probably, I believe that this regression or this is induced hyperopia maybe because of the relaxation of accommodation this patient experienced after the myopia in the right side. Probably the myopia in the right side causes some relaxation of accommodation that the patient used or utilized for the distant vision, revealing some latent hyperopia in the left side. So what to do in this case? Of course, I get the patient again for the second time for another re-enhancement for the left side, but I could just remove the flap or lift the flap and do the laser, but I didn't do so. I just went for direct surface ablation. Why? Because as you can see, this is the ablation zone to correct this hyperopic residual hyperopia for the left eye. You can see that the ablation zone is 8.9 millimeter and the diameter of the femtolasic flap was 8.9 millimeters. So this will carry a high risk of epithelial ingrowth because the laser shots will almost on the edge of the flap. And this, of course, will carry high risk for epithelial ingrowth. So that's why I resorted in this case to surface ablation. And as you know, the epithelial ingrowth increased with the retreatment and increased with the hyperopic ablation much more compared to myopic ablation profiles. So that's why I did the surface ablation, transepithelial PRK. And finally, the patient is satisfied. You can see this is the final reflection of this patient. Myopia of minus 0.75 in the right side and almost emmetrope in the left side. Now she's able to read and text on the mobile phone without reading glasses, and her vision binocularly is 1.2, one just one, and she's pleased with the quality of vision at that time. So the key points here, you have to understand that the patient complained in cases of retreatment or re-enhancement because you have to differentiate if the complaint is directly related to visual quality, some sort of coma, trefoil, or spherical aberration, or the acuity, which is the low order aberration, some sort of myopia, astigmatism, or hyperopia. Or sometimes the patient simply complains of presbyopia and the patient does not know that at the age of 40, the patient might use some reading spectacles. And simply, you can just tell the patient everything is fine. You can use the reading spectacle and the patient is fine with that. Some patients are highly demanding patients. They ask for solution for this presbyopia, and we can, of course, resort to the blended vision as Arthur mentioned. The other key points here, too, I would like to stress that the surgical planning is dependent on the chief complaint, whether it's related to the visual quality. So we have to use some sort of topography or wavefront-guided ablation profiles. Of course, the refractive history, if the patient has done surface ablation or just LASIK, you have to do either the flap lifting or just another side cut or just surface ablation. What about the flap thickness of the hair primary surgery or the previous surgery? And what about the epithelial mapping? If there is any hyperplasia or atrophy or thinning of the epithelium in some areas of the cornea, and of course, the refractive error. So all these factors will contribute to the surgical planning in the surgeon's mind for the retreatment and the enhancement. So my systematic approach in this case is, first of all, you have to rule out ectasia by asking for the topography and tomography to rule out ectasia, and then we can order for epithelium mapping to see if there is something wrong with the epithelium, and then we can discuss with the patient about the complaint and trying to speculate the complaint comes from either visual quality or visual acuity, either the low order aberration or higher order aberration or just presbyopia. And I don't trust for surgery in these cases. Just I prescribe a pair of glasses or just one glass for the patient. Tell the patient, try to live with these glasses for just a couple of weeks and come back again, see everything, how things is going on. If things is going on fine with the patient, so the patient can still keep his glasses or her glasses and stick with the glasses and that there is nothing wrong, and just put on the glasses whenever needed and that's it. And if the patient is still unsatisfied or dissatisfied because of the quality of vision with the glasses is not met by the patient demands, or the patient does not simply want to put on glasses. So in this case, I will go for the surgery. And of course, surgical planning depends upon different factors, as I mentioned in the previous slide. So thank you for your attention, and I'm ready for questions.
Well, thank you very much. That was very, very interesting. Can I have a quick question and wait on time? If there was residual myopia or astigmatism in the left eye, would you be considering surface ablation then?
Of course. If refractive error after the first retreatment, right? If the refractive error was myopia and not hypropia, I would do flap lifting and do laser ablation. But for this case in particular, because it was as hypropic residual error, and the ablation zone will be much wide, very close or at the flat edge, I resorted to surface ablation. So definitely I'll go for flap lifting if there is myopia residual
error. Anas, do you mind if I make a quick comment?
Please do.
Yeah, please.
I really like Ahmed's approach. It's always so systematic. He's got such a nice way of thinking things through. And the point I just wanted to make is the point we said he thinks this patient might have been induced into a latent hyperopia, even though the patient was myopic initially. And so I think it's one of the reasons, even though it's a lot of work, on all myopes, we still do cytoplegic refractions. And maybe only 1 or 2 in 100 times do you find that there's someone where you do get a surprise, but it's worthwhile doing. So I think you're absolutely right. That's exactly what the problem was. Your topography looked beautiful. Epithelial maps were perfect. Thank you. Very nice case.
Thank you very much. Yes, I did cytologic refraction for her, and it was only different about 0.75 from the manifest refraction. So in this case, I was reluctant to do the full cytologic refraction, so I went just for the subjective refraction for this patient. But this proved that I was wrong.
can I have a question, Ahmed?
Yes,
regarding
please.
The second retreatment, have you used mitomycin C in this second retreatment? Because you lasered the flap, actually.
I'm sorry. Every surface ablation, I do mitomycin routinely. 0.02% for 20
for
seconds.
How long?
Every surface ablation.
20 seconds.
20 seconds. 20 seconds.
Actually,
sometimes more.
I have... Exactly. I have different experience because I'm hitting a flap of a previous LASIK, the incidence of hazes is pretty high. So I use it like for 1 minute or even more before I wash it, because I start using mitomycin the old era when I started to use it for 2 minutes, two whole minutes. But now I'm using it regularly for 20 to 30 seconds. But if I have a risk factor like a previous flap, I use it longer time because I know the haze is imminent.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. That's why I use the mitomycin almost routinely in every case. Sometimes if the ablation is much more than 30 or 40 microns in depth, I might extend the application of mitomycin for about 50 seconds or maybe sometimes 60 seconds.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed. That's very interesting. I think in the interest of time, we should move on. I think barely we have a couple of minutes for questions. I'd just like to ask Dr. Tarek one question, if possible. Which maps would be more important, the elevation map or the axial map?
Well, Anna, thank you for your question. It's a very interesting question. I believe every map has its own value, but if we are talking about pentacam or scheimpflug images, I believe elevation maps are important, and even more important than the axial maps or curvature maps, because the machine is starting with anterior and posterior elevation, and then it calculates the elevation, the axial map. So I start looking at the anterior and posterior elevation, and then moving to the tachymetric map, followed by the axial map. But you know, because of the own inherited value of the axial map, people are start looking at the axial map first and get the impression before looking at the other maps. But you know, every map has its own importance, especially if you are going to treat. So treatment is based mainly on the axial map, not on the other maps.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Can I turn to Dr. Rashid and ask him to tell us about the thinnest cornea that you have done, and how often do you do that? Do you do that, I mean, in your practice every week, every month? Dr. Rashid, can you hear me? I think the microphone is blocked with Dr. Rashid.
Now it's okay.
Hello? Okay, perfect. Yes.
Sorry, yeah. I was on mute. Thank you for the next question. We started actually end of 2019. We did till now thin below 400, around six or seven patients. But we were still, we have to be careful. We are doing till now only up to 350 microns. We did not go thinner than 350. Because we want to try a few patients, and then we can do, we have some patients whom around 300 also, but we are waiting. Want to see like follow up 6 months for those patients. The thinnest till now we did 350. And the result actually promising for all those patients. But we have many patients, as I said, many patients in Oman, young patients, they present late to us. They are already advanced KC, and we need actually to do more and more patients below 400. Then we can save those patients at least till they finish their university or their higher college studies without any type of keratoplasty.
I see. And do you find any differences regarding complications and the consent form, for
instance? Consent form, of course, we have to tell the patient the risk, but we tell them the risk of waiting without treatment or we do the treatment. We found most of the parents, especially those below, those young patients around 16, they bring their parents with them. When we talk to them, they accept our idea. We tell them all over, because of course, by the law, we have to tell them what the risk, and we are doing the work with, maybe we can say off-label, somehow, if we can explain the correct word. But we have to tell them, but we found all patients agreed for the treatment before the waiting, more risky than having the treatment.
Well, thank you very much for joining us today. I just have room for one question to Dr. Tarek, perhaps. I'd like to know your approach to steep cornea, please.
That's a very difficult question to answer. Steep cornea is tough, actually. As I said in my presentation, this case is not keratoconus, the steep cornea one, but at the same time, I can treat it at ease because the K reading is 50. Even if I'm going to use 10 second laser to avoid bottom hole, but still, it is suspicious for me for ectasia susceptibility, but it is not a keratoconus again. For this case, actually, I follow it up for over 2 years now, and I instruct the patient not to rub her eyes. So to keep the biomechanics of the cornea solid, so it wouldn't progress easily. But if I have a steep cornea, and I'm sure it's stable, I can consult the patient that I'm going to do refractive surgery for her after making sure that it's pretty stable for a long time enough that I know she's not going to be pregnant soon. She's old enough that the corneal biomechanics is stable, and then I can go ahead and do the refractive surgery with femtosecond, as I mentioned, and then I will ask the patient to follow up regularly just in case if anything happens, so I can go ahead with mechanism in such cases.
Well, thank you very much indeed. Dr. Ahmed, I don't think we have more available time. We'd like to say the last word, perhaps.
Nothing to say. Thank you very much all for being with us. Thank you, Eva Pharma, for hosting this webinar. I would like to thank the panelists, Dr. Rashid, Renato, of course, Arthur Cummings, and my dearest friend, Dr. Tarek Elnaggar. And of course, I would like to thank you, Anas, for being with us and moderating this session with me. You did a very good job and you did a hard work, almost everything, every details. You are keen of such details in this webinar. And thank you very much again. and see you later.
Now, just a final word.
Last year, we were in San Diego together. Now we are in webinars in Cairo and Kuwait and everywhere in the world. But maybe next year we'll meet together.
we need to meet together next Las Vegas meeting in AO.
Hopefully. I hope so. Video of this webinar will be uploaded to the ISRS video library and is going to be available for all, for those who missed the photographs, photographing the slides of Dr. Cumming. Thank you very much again.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.